Well, good evening, everybody. Michael Soothing here. Tonight, I want to talk about escapes from the Rock, also known as Alcatraz or Alcatraz Island, which I covered recently in a recent video all about Alcatraz. But in this video, I have a new topic, which is all of the escape attempts from Alcatraz. I'm also going to chew some bubble yum chewing gum. So for those of you who don't like gum chewing, you know, I'm just giving you a little bit of a warning. But and we'll talk a little bit about the famous Clint Eastwood film Escape from Alcatraz, as well as the film, the great film that it inspired, called The Shawshank Redemption, based on a short novel or novella by Stephen King. So with all that said, and some of the similarities between the true story, Escape from Alcatraz, and the Stephen King-inspired screenplay, Shawshank Redemption, which many have said is the best film they've ever seen, or the most memorable, or certainly on their top 10 list. So I consider it very excellent. Joanne feels a little differently. She doesn't like that elements of the story were plagiarized from the Alcatraz film. But anyway, let me... One thing I really appreciated about the Clint Eastwood film, Escape from Alcatraz, is it was all filmed there on location. And since we just visited there recently, it was really interesting to recognize all the different parts of the prison out there in San Francisco Bay. So let's talk about this. A tour of the attempts to escape. There's the famous guard tower. You arrive at, it says, "Welcome to Alcatraz." You arrive at U.S. Penitentiary Alcatraz in shackles. On the prison launch crossing the bay, you watch the lights of San Francisco recede. You recall what you heard about the city, its nightlife, its restaurants, its beautiful buildings and wealthy citizens. For you, the city might as well be a mirage, though you see it and smell it and can even hear it sometimes when there's loud parties or on New Year's or 4th of July. I lost my place. Oh, and even hear it. It has left you behind. Once on the island and in the cell house, you are stripped, searched, and issued prison clothes. After you shower in the open shower room, your uniform is handed to you along with a number and a copy of the institution rules and regulations. You're taken to your cell, and with a crash of metal against metal, the steel barred door of the general population isolation cell slam shut behind you. Even though you're alone in the cell, there's no privacy. The man in the cell across from you can see you sleep, shave, or use the toilet. Your cell is cold and small, 5 foot wide, 9 foot deep, 7 foot high, with cement walls, a steel frame bed with a thin mattress, a sink with a single cold water tap, a toilet with no seat. That sounds cold. And a small table and seat that fold down from the wall. Your cell door can only be opened by the guard. Armed guards watch you from the towers and the gun galleries constantly throughout the day and count you throughout the night. Multiple counts. What and when you eat, when you sleep, when you shower, all dictated by the prison, not your own preferences, etc., etc. They're painting a picture of why you might want to escape. Now, we covered in our previous video on Alcatraz the history, the military prison history of Alcatraz, and the federal penitentiary history of Alcatraz. So we will not go back and cover that again. Here is the layout of the prison blocks themselves. As you can see, but what we will cover today is some of the escape attempts. Escape attempt sites. They show some of the places that people tried to escape from. Let me get this folded properly. The A dock, the closet in front of the lighthouse was another spot. The stop, the guardhouse sallyport. Here's an overview of the entire island. The penitentiary sits up on top, and then there's a road. When you go visit, you walk up that diagonal road that zigzags to the top there, you know, up here and up. You see all the guard towers. You go through all the cells. And it looks like it would be really, really difficult to figure out an escape. If you did get out of the prison somehow and into the water of San Francisco Bay, it's very cold. Hypothermia would set in within a few minutes. And additionally, there's a very strong current that would either sweep you into the giant portion of the bay where you might drown, or sweep you out to sea through the Golden Gate. And that current is so strong, you wouldn't be able to swim to shore fast enough, generally speaking, right? So, what happened with the escape attempts? Let's go through them not in great detail, but we'll do an overview. Here's a bird's eye view, removing the roof, of how the penitentiary was laid out. The rows of cells that all the guys were locked in. And there was a gun gallery up at this end where guards would walk back and forth on a raised platform behind a wire mesh fence that no prisoner could get to. And they had guns up there so that if anybody started any nonsense down here, they could open fire and were protected from anyone getting their gun off of them. Anyway, let's see what a couple of the things that happened with escape attempts. The recreation yard doorway, where the Model Industries building was, where they did work on various projects and workshops. This was the site of 4 escape attempts. That would be down at this end of the island down here. 4 escape attempts. Let's read about a couple of those. On December 16th, 1937, Ralph Rowe and Theodore Cole vanished from the mat shop into the swift current and thick fog. They were never seen again and are presumed to have drowned. Officer Royal Klein was clubbed to death with a hammer. Not very soothing. On May 23rd, 1938, when Thomas Liverick, Rufus Franklin, and James Lucas tried to escape from the furniture shop, Liverick was killed, Franklin was wounded, and Lucas was captured while climbing the guard tower on top of the building in an attempt to get the guard's gun. Sam Shockley and Joseph Kretzer would later make another more violent attempt and were among 4 men involved in the May 1941 episode in the Model Industries mat shop. In April 1943, 4 guys I won't name overpowered 2 guards using homemade knives and dashed for the bay. The tower guard fired on them in the water, killing Borman, and then 2 were captured in the water, and Hamilton was found several days later, hiding in a cave on the north end of the island, where I presume he had been without food or water, so he was probably in very bad shape. But they have outlined here all of the escape attempts, see? There were many escape attempts, but we know of only one that might have been successful, and that is the one that is recreated in the movie Escape from Alcatraz. But let's run through the escape attempts that were earlier and see how tough it was to get out of this place. The first one was in 1936. Joseph Bowers didn't get far. He climbed the fence in full view of a guard and was shot dead. That doesn't sound very successful to me. I hate it when I try to climb the fence and I get shot dead. I won't try that one. Escape attempt 2, 1937. Ralph Rowe and Theodore Cole were never seen again. They sawed through a window bar in the Model Industries building, squeezed through it, and disappeared. It's possible they got away, but unlikely given the current and that they had no flotation device. Escape attempt 3. The four guys, we just covered that one a minute ago. Not successful. The fourth attempt, Arthur Doc Barker and some other guys, a whole bunch, sawed through the window bars in D block and scrambled to the water's edge. Barker was fatally wounded and all of the others were captured. There were guards with guns and guard towers all over the place on the island, you know. The fifth attempt, 1941. They overpowered guards in the mat shop, but gave up after an unsuccessful attempt to saw through the window bars. Sixth attempt, John Bayliss made a one-man escape attempt when he slipped away from a garbage detail near the powerhouse. He was spotted in the water and brought back. Cold, wet, and shivering, I'll bet, ready for a hot meal. But they probably put him in the hole, you know, the dark isolation cells. Attempt 7. Floyd Hamilton and some other guys broke through a weird, oh, we'd covered that one already. One was fatally shot and the others were found in the water and picked up by the prison launch boat. And the other guy was in a cave, the one they didn't catch immediately, hiding. Escape attempt 8, August 1943. Ted Walters sneaked out of the laundry. I have snuck out of the laundry from time to time myself, and climbed over the fence. He was found entering the bay with two large cans tied around his waist for buoyancy. That was a pretty clever attempt. I think he might have had a legitimate chance if they didn't catch him. Attempt 9. John Giles, this was 1945. He collected an entire army uniform during 8 years working on the dock, a piece of clothes at a time. He stripped off the coveralls that concealed the uniform and walked onto the army launch, pretending to be an army officer, a precautionary count taken on the boat revealed the extra man. He would have got away with it if they weren't counting heads, you know. Escape attempt 10. This was the biggest and bloodiest and longest because there was a group of guys and it was known as the Battle of Alcatraz. May 1946. The battle raged for 3 days when 6 inmates, they're all named here, attempted to break out of the cell house. They overpowered several guards and captured weapons. They took over the cell house, but did not get the key to the exterior door. That was a strange oversight, given all their planning. By the end of the siege, guards William Miller, Harold Stites, and some of the convicts were dead. Two other convicts were executed for their role in the escape. If you ever do the Alcatraz tour, you can hear in the audio as you're passing that section where it occurred, and you can still see the big striations in the floor where the grenades went off when the Marines came out to Alcatraz to stop the battle. Escape attempt 11. Floyd Wilson disappeared from the dock crew and hid in a crevice in the rocks. He worked his way along the seawall, eluding search parties for 12 hours before finally being discovered. What a drag after all that effort. It's sort of like, you know, when a team makes it all the way to the playoffs and to the AFC Championship and then barely loses after having a large lead, you know, loses to the New England Patriots. Anyway, escape attempt 12. After tying a guard to a tree, well, that's a novel approach, Clyde Johnson and Aaron Burgett ran from their garbage detail to the shoreline. After 2 hours, Johnson was found clinging to the seawall. Burgett was missing for 13 days before his drowned body was discovered in the bay. Now here we come, finally, to escape 13. Was it unlucky that it was escape 13 attempt or not? You be the judge. June 11th, 1962. Frank Morris and brothers Clarence and John Englund escaped from their cells through enlarged air vents. They had been chipping away at their air vents for months using homemade scraping and chipping tools that they welded out of stolen forks and spoons and things. And they cleverly made covers for the air vent and painted them so that it looked like the air vent was still there. You know, it was an illusion because the guards didn't really go into their cells typically. So in the back wall, they had a paper mache creation that had the air vent painted in it, and it would recess into that spot. They also made dummy heads and bodies so that the night of the escape, it would look like they were sleeping in their cell when the every 2 hour head count would be made, right? So that was very clever. Anyway, after they tunneled their way into the utility corridor between the cell block cells, they climbed up onto the roof at the top of the cell block along a ventilator shaft. They went down a cast iron stovepipe and entered the water with flotation devices made from raincoats and contact cement, and they were never seen again. Some say they might have made it down to South America, because they were all studying Spanish before the escape attempt. Since no trace was ever found of any of them, I would say they might have pulled it off. You know, had someone waiting for them on shore with a car somewhere. And then finally, escape attempt 14, the last attempt and the only known successful swim from Alcatraz to the mainland, that is known as well as far as being verified, John Paul Scott and Darrell Parker sawed through bars in a basement room under the kitchen using inflated gloves. Talk about inflating. I need another piece of chewing gum to finish our story here. Hold on. Bubble yum is kind of yummy. Actually, I think. Oops. One tried to get away. Blow your own bubbles, it says. Well, I think that's good advice, because I wouldn't want to blow someone else's bubble. You know what I mean? That might be a little yucky. Anyway, where were we? The final attempt. These two guys, using the inflated gloves, jumped in and swam. Parker gave up and turned back, probably freezing cold at that point, barely able to swim. Scott was found clinging to rocks near the Golden Gate Bridge, too exhausted to pull himself out of the water. So there you have it. 14 escape attempts, none verified for certain as successful, but escape 13 might have been successful. Frank Morris and the other two guys. And the movie Escape from Alcatraz does a great job of showing how they did it and leaves it up to you to speculate what happened to them after that. Now, The Shawshank Redemption, a 4-star film that I believe won Academy Award or awards, and is, you know, in many top 10 lists of all-time best films, drew heavily on the Alcatraz story. Here are some of the parallels. Both prisons had decaying concrete. On Alcatraz, it was from the salt air, you know. And so it made it easy for the guys to chip away at it and take chunks out. In both stories, they were hauling the stuff they were removing from the wall out into the prison yard in their pants and then dropping it surreptitiously out on the ground. Both stories had the digging tools concealed in a cutouts in a Bible in the cell. Both had an evil-minded warden who had an inflated ego and overconfidence and a pretty big dash of sadistic tendency in them in a way. Both films had bad guys being, you know, terrible to the star character, Frank Morris, in the Alcatraz film, and Shawshank, who was the star? Is his name Tim Robbins? Anyway, Morgan Freeman narrates that film and was in it as one of the co-stars. Did a great job too. Both films have an older guy. In both films, the main character works with the library, the prison library, to do certain shenanigans. Both films had an inmate that had a kind of a bird fetish. The true story, Birdman of Alcatraz. And then in Shawshank, the older guy that had the bird he raised from a baby. That was about all he really cared about. Both had something covering the tunneled out opening they were making in the back of their cell. In the case of Shawshank, I won't give away the rest of the plot. But anyway, what could you use for flotation to swim away from Alcatraz? Maybe large bubble gum bubbles, but that might not be enough. I think I'd have to chew this a lot longer if I want to make bubbles. And my little screen here is saying I have 3 minutes of time left on my SD card because my lovely spouse must have loaded this card up already with video footage, because she's a much more prolific video maker than I am. But anyway, look what I bought. Bait casting sinkers for surf fishing. And a nice steelhead lure. Super duper. That's way off topic. Just like me telling you that in my next video, I intend to look at the old classic car calendar and discuss cars I've owned in the past and memories with those cars. If I can do it without getting into too much trouble. Filipinas are jealous. Even if you had a relationship 40 years ago with someone and you only made out a little bit in your car, they don't want to ever know about it or they get upset. Okay? Very jealous, the Filipinas. So, but it's a sign of affection and love. It's a cultural thing, what can I say? Not that there isn't jealousy in all other cultures, okay? There is, but since I only have 1 minute left, make sure that you don't ASMR and drive. Till next time, take care.